want to start with a poem. And I wrote it for my daughter. It's called He's Watching. Mysterious nights went by slowly unnumbered, while her innocent body lay in enchantingly deep slumber. A monster in the dark lurked about, so conjured up evil for her so there was no way out. He cast his evil spell that fathomed her soul. No one was she to tell when from her innocence he stole. There's nowhere to run, and there's nowhere to hide. He's sneering, he's waiting, and he's watching. Signs of the dawn suddenly appear, and the secrets of the night are profoundly made clear. King of the giants, with all their knowledge, could not foresee the woe, the pain, and the misery. Poison still lingers in the air, but no need to worry, for he is still there. He's sneering, he's waiting, he's watching. The sun begins to shine through the shadowy veil. Time heals all wounds, and life prevails. The evil of the night no longer hovers over her breast. She can sleep without crying, her fear is put to rest. Her beauty is more captivating with each passing day. Yet, tawny memories still creep in her way. He's sneering, he's waiting, and he's watching. Pulled out of dreamland by an overwhelming fright. Make him stop. What's that sound? I'm scared. Who keeps lurking in the night? Her trembling heart is silenced by the refuge that is near. Was it a dream, or is he still there? Her conscience is seared. She knows he is still there. He's sneering. He's waiting. He's watching somewhere. You know, we began the Shattered Silence Tour documentary project in August 2012 in Shreveport, Louisiana. And while we were fighting for the rights of the women and the children in our local area, we decided, you know, this got to be happening all across the nation, because while we were fighting for the legal rights across the nation, we found that we're fighting the good old boy justice system. We have DAs who did not want to get involved. We have local attorneys who just, you know, just were this mindful of all the things that were going on. So we said, this has got to stop. Our children are counting on us. It's 2013. We're living in a multi-generational epidemic. We can't have this anymore. We have got to leave a better legacy to our children. We cannot have that. And you ask people, you know, you ask people to tell. Well, children are not going to tell a trusted adult, because it's usually the trusted adult in the home or around the neighborhood or the community that is doing the perpetrating. It's not the stranger on the street. You know, so the Department of Justice says there's 1 in 3 girls and 1 in 6 boys, but now they're saying it's 1 in 4 boys that were sexually assaulted before their 18th birthday. That's a lot of kids, and if you look around today and you count that down, there's a lot of people still not talking, because 90% do not tell. And we're here to shatter the silence on child sexual assault and human trafficking. Whenever I was a kid growing up, my dad had left my mother, so she was busy working a lot, raising 5 children on her own. One day, when I was about 8, she married this guy who seemed like a really nice guy, but he ended up coming home one night drunk and he tried to kill her, so the police shot him dead. And then about a year after that, she married another guy, and he made the first guy look like a saint. When we're coming from school, we never knew what to expect. She would be beaten with black and blue with his fist or with a gun stock or whatever he could find handy. And since he liked wrestling so much, many days he would make us all the kids in circle while he held my mom on the floor and he beat her with his fist. And with every pounding, it made you just want to throw up. And this is the monster that raped me when I was 11. And so when he was through, he said, now don't you feel better? Well, no, I didn't feel better. It's like the lowest rock I could have crawled under wouldn't have been low enough. So it's just like, you know, child sexual assault has affected our family. And you wonder why it keeps affecting generation after generation after generation. When I was 17, I married this guy who seemed to be really, really nice. He said, whatever you do, we can do together, which really grabbed me, because a lot of times I had grown up abandoned, I'd grown up alone, felt like I'd been unloved and rejected. And so it was after 7 years of verbal abuse and physical abuse that I left with my children, who were 5, 4, and 1. I raised them alone by myself, put us through college, put us through VOTEC. And while I was an undergrad in South Arkansas University, I conducted my psychological research on why we fall in love with who we do. And to put a year's worth of analysis in a few short sentences, it goes down to this. When we're young and we're watching how our parents interact with one another, that imprints on our heart and it imprints on our mind. And so whether they be loving and nurturing or giving and caring, that becomes your comfort zone. And if they're abusive, neglectful, abandon you, emotionally, physically, sexually assault you, or belittle you, just whatever made you feel less than you should have as a child, that becomes your comfort zone. So while you say, I'll never be like my mother and I'll never be like my father, what happens is, not consciously, but subconsciously, when you get a little older, you start developing relationships and you find somebody just like your parents. And that's how a lot of first marriages do not work. You know, it's crazy, because there's so many people that we encounter in our lives and we think, why aren't they standing up for us? Why are they not protecting us? Why are they not saying You know, this is wrong. Why are they just accepting it in our society? Kids can't have that anymore. We can't live in a generation where we hear the cries in the night and not say anything and not do anything. That's just an uncalled for. Many people who live at home, you know, they think that everything's going well. They see signs that they'll just ignore them. They'll say, this doesn't happen in our family. But if you see a child who's having nightmares, who's having crying spells, if they're having vaginal or genital irritations, if they're afraid of a certain place or a certain thing, you know, there's something going on, and you really need to take heed to that. So what do you do if you think your child is being sexually abused? If they're a little bit older, it may come out in their play, in their art, in their music, or their dance. They may start cutting. They may try to commit suicide. There's some 1-800 numbers on our flyers. It's 1-800 domestic violence line. There's a 1-800 child sexual assault hotline. You can call your local law enforcement and your local CPS, and they will come to your aid. So it's just important that you learn the tools and the resources necessary so you won't say this is not happening in our family, that you will stand up and you will fight for your children, despite that it's going to cost you a great deal, and you may lose family members who do not want you to keep the family secret because it's a shame and society still in 2013. We just can't have it anymore. Today is not the day that we say that we're going to say be silent anymore. This is not our generation. You know, a lot of people don't realize this, but human trafficking is now a $32 billion industry all across this nation, all across our globe. But also, 50% of all global porn is made here in the United States. I'm going to repeat that. 50% of all global porn is made here in the United States, made with our children, with our babies. Children under 3 are considered platinum, and I'll let you figure that out. We just can't have that anymore. We're having a big problem, as we've been touring across the country, we've been seeing a big problem with high schools and junior highs, where the local prostitution and pimp rings are targeting high school students and junior high students, and they'll get one guy or one girl to go in and befriend this person and pretend like they're their boyfriend and that they love them and nobody understands. Sort of like what online perpetrators do. You know, they gain your trust, they isolate you, and then they pull you into the prostitution ring, but if you decide to leave, they'll beat you down with physical assault, sexual assault, drugs, alcohol, and then you continue the cycle until that either that prostitution ring is kicked out of the schools or, you know, death occurs. We just can't have that. We've got to wake up, people. This is not our generation anymore. We refuse to be silent. It is time for us to stand up and say, we've heard your cries in the night. We've heard the children who are silent. We know what's going on in our communities, and as advocates and organizations, we're going to stand up together today. And we're going to say, I will not be silent anymore. We can no longer say we're going to turn away in indifference, or that's just too hard, or it's just too big of a topic for dinner. So we just ask that you join local organizations like Rico's, my sister's house. Join the Violent Parents Coalition of Mark Scalms. Follow Lisa Leonessa Garbagiglia, Beyond Abuse Radio, or join the Fox and Foundation Revolution. Because today is the day we said we're going to stand together. Today is the day we're going to band and we're going to unite. And today is the day we're going to say, I stand for children. I fight for children. I will no longer be silent. This is not our generation. Today is the day that you are responsible for the children and you are accountable and they are counting on you. So thank you for coming to the Shattering the Silence Tour Documentary Project. God bless and Godspeed.